Dennis, would you like to introduce yourself?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Dennis Mwanza, and I'll be supporting Kevin in this moderating and chairing of the session. Otherwise, I work for RTI, but based in the UK. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Okay, so this session is on sustainable wash interventions. We've got two papers, one from Amans, Ntakarutimana, on challenges for sustainable access to improve wash in Burera District in Rwanda. And then the second presentation is from Tsedey, Tamir, on sustaining wash in school programming, lessons from West and Central Africa. Great, so without further ado, I'll start the first presentation.
Warm greetings all. My name is Amans Ntakarutimana from University of Rwanda. I'm presenting the result of an assessment conducted on challenges of sustainability of wash services and the practices in Rwanda. We conducted the assessment 1 year after the implementation of a five-year project to accelerate water sanitation and the hygiene in the volcanic region of Rwanda. The volcanic region of Rwanda comprises four districts, including Nyabihu, Musanze, Rubavu, and the Burera. We focused on the Burera district. We recognize much effort in terms of institutional strengthening and financial support to improve wash services and the practices in Rwanda. After 1 year of the implementation of a five-year wash project in the volcanic region of Rwanda, which was to accelerate water sanitation and hygiene practices to reduce wash-related disease, we conducted the assessment to see if there may be some challenges of sustainability for solutions. We conducted a semi-structured interview from district level to community level, and stakeholders who were involved in the implementation of the WASH project, stakeholders involved in the monitoring and evaluation of the WASH services and the practices, the stakeholders involved in sustaining the WASH services and the practices at a community level, and the beneficiaries were represented. As a result, households reported the poverty as one of the challenges of WASH sustainability at the community level. The system delivery of the WASH services, the implementers, reported limited budget, low involvement of local leaders, and low adoption of WASH practices as challenges of sustainability of WASH practices at the community level. Household and the local leaders reported some water supply system breakdowns, shortage of water, but also some challenges in relation to building of latrines, maintenance of public latrines, and also the durable hand washing facilities. They said there is a need of support so that communities can be able to build their latrines in a region where we have a soil to dig, which is hard, or a high water table. Last, the data in terms of wash practices and the challenges were not flowing easily from villages to district level. And the lack of early data affect early solutions. There is a need of early data for early interventions. At the end, the challenges are mainly related to the implementation of WASH interventions, because at the level of the implementation process of WASH interventions, it is there we have to ensure there is a capacity of stakeholders, not only on the knowledge of WASH, but also on the capacity, they have capacity in terms of leadership skills to mobilize available resources and rationally use them for effective implementation of WASH interventions, where we have gap, see if it can be solved, filled locally, or where we have some resources, how can we use them so that we can have collective solutions. This also requires to commit seriously the local artisans, local masons, and the other private sector actors at the community level, so that together with the local leaders, the interventions, implementers, and the beneficiaries can have collective solutions so that they can fill a gap which is there in budget, but also in a human resource, but also in materials. Then there is a need of enhancing the monitoring and the reporting systems, because early data, early solutions. We may think of how at the community level, the district can maximize the resources which are available for a community-based monitoring for solving solutions on time. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
This was the presentation. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Amans, for that presentation, looking at the challenges. It was good to see that you were, or you and your organization were systematic in having interviews with people at all different levels, from community up to government. I've tried to connect Amans, but he said a message that he will not be able to speak. So could I ask people to, if they've got any questions, please put them in the chat, and Dennis will review these questions and pass them on.
Now, I do not see any question yet, but I have one or two questions that I came up with. One is, you've mentioned that it is important to use the local artisans, you know, like technicians and so on. But now these are people who need to be paid. But you are also saying that this area has these people who are quite poor in terms of poverty. So how would these people, pay for this service? Before I go to the next one, I've seen that there are some questions. Thanks. Did you involve the community at the planning stage? I hope you're following the two questions so that you can type in your answers as you have rightly stated. The third one is, what options were considered for methods of drinking water treatment? So one is on the artisans and poverty. The second question is on, on the involvement of the community at the planning stage. And last question is options. If there were any options considered for methods of treatment, of treating water. Please, if you can type in your answers in the chat, Ntakarutimana, Amans, if you can type in the responses, as you mentioned that you are not able to speak. Thank you so much.
So it seems Amans is typing at the moment.
Okay. So apart from that, we don't have any additional question. There is one last one, which is on the data, which is, it's a very important decision-making tool. The question is there any centralized data collection center which can be used for monitoring the systems? So as you respond, Amans, you can include that question on the data issue. Okay.
Well, one thing that I observed in the presentation that, you know, they were thorough in asking people about the challenges, but they came up with quite a limited number of actions. I would have thought there would have been more actions.
That's true.
I guess it's very early for people in the United States. I expect you know, Dennis, because you used to live there.
I know. Yeah. Sure. It's actually 7:45 just now in the US. Yeah, in the morning.
So it's very early.
There's another question which Amans, you may wish to respond to. And this is, what is the government and other stakeholders doing about these challenges that you have highlighted or that you found?
We got a response from Amans as well.
Okay, yes, I've seen the response. So the first one is on the poverty issue. Even if it was reported, it wasn't really a global issue. So which means that there's some kind of affordability levels. It was just because of people were not well involved. Okay. So there were not all of them was involved. And then local stakeholders to help where that was possible. And for vulnerable households, there were other methods of paying for them, which is great. I mean, this is ensuring that at least people are not denied that service for lack of funding or lack of funds. So there were some kind of programs to cushion to pay for those services. Thank you so much. I can see that Amans is still typing the responses. Well, yeah, Sam is just mentioning that the sun is just rising in Chicago, which I believe is also, yeah, it's early morning that side. So it's great, and it's very interesting because England is kind of gloomy. You know, it's all cloud, it's clouded over, and it's showering. It's interesting.
That's typical for England, really.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, and Amans, thank you so much for your response to the second part, which is planning and about involvement. And you're saying that all stakeholders were involved. I think we saw it even in the presentation where he talked about the different stakeholders that were contacted as they're doing the research. So they were involved, but still there's need to much more, okay, as usual, you always find some people left behind here and there. So there's always need to be, to always review and see what kind of stakeholders you may have missed out in your project design. Yeah. So from what he's saying is that while stakeholders were involved and all the different approaches tried, the actual implementation was the challenge. And I believe most of the people that may be here in the audience, it is very easy to come up with the right plans, come up with the right policies and strategies and so on. But usually the challenges that we face in many of our countries is the implementation. Sometimes you may even have the funding available, but you find that implementation is still a challenge. So this is something that I think that we need to be innovative about on how we can implement the programs that are normally designed.
So that means that capacity,
yeah,
and collaboration is very important on these programs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like you say, Dan, it's easier to write the nice project plans, but
sure,
more difficult to implement.
Yeah, that's very true.
So we assume we're going to have to move on to the second presentation.
Yes, I think so.
It looks like he's typing a long message.
Yeah. Would we miss the chat if we move to the next presentation?
Yeah, we could come back to Amans' response, I suppose. Or he's just given his response there.
Okay, this is on the treatment. So water treatment at community level and household level is basically boiling. Chemical treatment with chlorine is usually at the system, that's at the treatment plant level. So basically, I think what he's saying is that households are encouraged to boil the water as one way of, more like treating. while at the source, in terms of where the water comes from, the treatment plant, they use chemicals like chlorine.
Yeah, good. I remember when I was in Rwanda, they had plenty of rain, so gravity systems can work there.
That's true. In fact, that's what is mentioned, because as we know, Rwanda is a country of so many hills and mountains, if I could call it, or maybe hills, a thousand hills. So a lot of gravity systems in Rwanda. Right. And that's what has been written here, that the water supply was by gravity piped water supply system. Okay, so I think, Kevin, we can move to the, you can move to the next presentation.
Great. Okay, well, thanks, Amans, for your presentation and your typing in the chat. It's a pity we couldn't speak to you. But all the best with your program. So now we'll move on to the next presentation. So this is Sustaining Washing School Services, Lessons from West and Central Africa. So Tamir is the lead author and also standing ready to answer questions. So let's start.
Hi everyone, my name is Tsedey Tamir and I'm a WASH officer at UNICEF's Regional Office for West and Central Africa. Today I'll be presenting to you a study on the lessons we learned on sustaining washing schools in West and Central Africa. So why do we talk about washing schools? Well, global evidence suggests that school-based WASH interventions have a number of positive effects on protection against WASH-related illnesses, educational achievements, and WASH-related knowledge and practices. West and Central Africa as a region has the highest number of children without access to WASH schools. As you'll see from the numbers provided in the slide, more than 60 million children lack access to drinking water or sanitation in the region. The outbreak of COVID-19 has underscored now more than ever the need to accelerate progress of a basic access to WASH in schools in the region. What do we mean by basic access? In the case of WASH in schools, it means drinking water is always available from a safe source on premise. It means the availability and functionality of single-sex, private, and usable sanitation facilities. And as for hygiene, basic service means that the availability of hand washing facilities with water and soap. If you look to your right, you'll see a graph representation of the service ladders used by the Global Joint Monitoring Program of WASH that are designed to track country progress towards a basic level of service of WASH in schools. In the region, the majority of countries had rates of basic service in all areas of WASH at less than 50%. These are the values you see circled in red in the graph. What is being done to respond to these challenges in WASH in schools coverage in the region? WASH in school services are a subset of both the WASH and education sectors. What this means is that inputs for WASH in schools at national and subnational levels include government engagement of these two sectors through policies, budgeting, and normative guidance. At school level, it includes both a hardware and software component. The hardware component includes the operation and maintenance of WASH-related infrastructure, while the software component is used to support the upkeep of good hygiene practices. So what are the progress trends for WASH in schools? If you look at the graph on the right, you'll see that the absolute number of school-age children without basic water services represented in orange has been growing with time, but that this is not matched with a proportionate decrease in the percentage of children lacking access to basic water. In the past two decades, progress in improving WASH in schools has been unable to keep up with school-age population growth. Why is this so? One of the arguments for this is that most WASH in schools initiatives in the region are donor-funded and lack specific strategies that chart the pathway for scale and sustainability. So what do we specifically know so far about sustainability of WASH in schools? So far, little is known on the sustainability of WASH in school services in the region. And beyond the region, two reports, one global and another regional, found some interesting results. In 2017, UNICEF conducted a global synthesis of WASH in schools evaluations that examined the sustainability of WASH in school services. One of their main findings was that when we break down sustainability according to technological, social, financial, institutional, and environmental categories, interventions were not intentionally designed for sustainability. Bringing this point closer to home, UNICEF conducted a scoping study of the barriers to sustainability in Eastern Southern Africa in 2018 and concluded that there was need to ensure that upstream services, systems and structures are effectively translated into sustainable access downstream. This led us to ask the question of whether these findings could extend to the Western Central African region, and whether we could use the same analytical lens of this global synthesis to examine sustainability of the provision of wash and school services in the region. Using the same global synthesis of wash and schools, which offered a definition of sustainability that we adopted, we defined sustainability as the ability of intervention outputs, outcomes, and impacts to continue after the withdrawal of all forms of assistance from an external development agency during a minimal period of 1 year. So the specific objective of the study is to contribute to adding to knowledge by identifying and characterizing the factors that contribute to improving the sustainability of wash and school services in Western Central Africa. The analytical framework we used relied on measuring sustainability of wash and school services using three of the five factors defined in UNICEF framework for sustainability. These are institutional, technological, and financial factors. The other two factors, social and environmental, were not analyzed due to a lack of data within this specific study. These three factors that we focused on were analyzed at two levels of interventions, not the national level and school level. There is a third level, which is the service provider level, but due to a lack of data, we only focused on these two levels. So how do we quickly define these three specific factors of interest? Institutional factors denote the coordination systems, policies and procedures that are led and conducted by government bodies at various levels. Technological factors refer to the technology or hardware necessary for wash and services. Lastly, financial factors encompass the sources of funding for services at national and school level. The methodological design of this study relied on a desk review based on program documentation of two sources of data. The first source was from a regional bottleneck analysis of institutional capacity for wash and schools conducted by the regional office. The data collection consisted of a self-administered survey examining the bottlenecks affecting institutional capacity at two points in time, 2016 and 2019, and it extended to 22 countries. The second source consisted of data extracted from sustainability assessments of a regional wash initiative implemented in Western Central Africa from 2013 to 2017. These sustainability assessments were carried out systematically every year or every other year independently from implementers. This regional initiative extended to 9 countries for which data was available across 255 schools. The overall analysis of the study was restricted to the overlap of countries between the two data sets. That is a total of 9 countries that had data from both secondary sources. Work used for the study. The results of the regional survey on institutional capacity provides national level data, while the sustainability assessments provide school level data for each of the three sustainability factors that were of interest to us. In keeping with the analytical framework, the findings were cited according to institutional, technological, and financial factors at national and school level. With regards to institutional factors at national level, 70% of countries reported the existence of wash and schools education policy, but only 44% have an accompanying strategy. All surveyed countries reported a presence of wash-related indicators in their national education management information systems. However, these indicators were not always aligned with global SDG monitoring indicators. 44% of countries reported the existence of a national level framework for ensuring wash and schools sustainability. At the school level, 56% of countries reported the existence of operations and maintenance mechanisms. However, only 33% of countries indicated the actual occurrence of regular monitoring and inspection mechanisms. With regards to financial factors, at national level, the main funding sources range from bilateral donors to NGOs. Only three countries cited national governments as the main source of funding, and 80% of countries indicated that there are costing estimates available for wash and school services. However, only two countries indicated the presence of a dedicated budget line for wash and schools in their education sector budgets. At school level, the availability of funds is necessary for the continued operation and maintenance of wash facilities in schools. The results from the sustainability assessment show that in the three countries that had data, less than 50% of schools have allocated funds for operation and maintenance of facilities. With regards to technological factors, at the national level, 70% of countries reported the presence of national guidelines for the implementation of wash in school services. However, two countries were not included in this figure because the guidelines were project-based and have not been adopted at national level. At school level, the study looked at the presence, functionality, and accessibility of facilities. These three aspects were not consistently assessed and varied greatly across countries. Several countries did not consider evidence of usage or functionality of the facilities while collecting data. One of the main conclusions we can make based on these findings is that policy-level interventions are important, but they are insufficient as they do not automatically translate into improved sustainability of school-level services. Poor institutional coordination on wash in schools, especially between education and wash sectors at the national level, poses complex challenges for the financing and maintenance of basic wash services. The results for financial factors show that the presence of a wash in schools-related budget line at a national level does not necessarily support school-level allocation and availability of funds for the operation and maintenance of wash services. With regards to technological factors, while several countries indicated the integration of indicators for wash in schools in national information systems, only a few keep accurate track of continued functionality of services. Overall, findings show that national-level policies are not adequately translated to local-level planning and implementation. Now that we've had a chance to examine the new learnings that this study provided, we'll examine what the limitations were, noting that while, yes, these limitations mean that we should interpret our results with caution, they do not refute them. One of the major limitations was that we used program-level data, and thus making it challenging to accurately extrapolate the findings to a national scale. There was inconsistent sampling across and within regions. And lastly, sustainability checks don't distinguish between newly built facilities and older facilities, which skews the functionality rates which were used within the context of the study. So to conclude, the findings in the study provide indicative leads for the robust design and conduct of future research on the factors affecting sustainability of water. School services in the region that's poorly studied. More rigorous country-specific studies and comprehensive data are necessary to fully understand the impact that each factor has on the sustainability of wash and school services, particularly at the school level. Future studies should also include the other two factors of sustainability that we did not have the opportunity to look at, so environmental and social factors, and should also include analyses at the service provider level. The study highlights that while costing
Okay, thank you, Tamir, for a comprehensive study of wash in schools in Western Central Africa. So you've been systematic in your frameworks, looking at sustainability, etc. We're just waiting for some more questions. Hi, Tamir, thanks for joining us. So I thought the finance.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can, yeah. One thing I thought was okay. the financial issues, I've noticed it in other regions where there's low percentage of funds or countries with money allocated for O&M of wash facilities, and also low percentage of countries with dedicated budgets for washing schools. But just looks like we've got a couple of questions, but just I thought that this is a really good analysis, but it'd be nice to have some case studies where things are working well to balance it out. But anyway, I'll hand over to Dennis, who can field the questions.
Yeah, Tamir, we have two, actually three questions, but let me ask the first two, which have come from Will Tillett. Great reconnecting with Will. So the question, the first question is the wash in schools, but that is the bottleneck analysis tool available to share? Well, yeah, that's the first question. The second one is, was political will and accountability processes looked at in terms of ensuring adequate wash services in the in the schools? So I'll first ask those two questions, then there's one or two more coming up, but let's first hear your response to those two questions.
Okay, great. Thank you both, Kevin, Dennis, and Will, for your question. So in terms of the wash in schools, the BAT tool, we adapted it from the WashBAT tool that that was I think globally developed a couple of years ago. So this is a sort of in-house tool, but I am I will share my email, and I'm more than happy to share the sort of the framing that we use to do this. But I think it's developed from the global one. As for the second question on political will and accountability processes. So I think we did not have a specific question on political will, but I think one way we captured this information was looking at sort of the, and this was particularly in the assessment of institutional capacity. We had a question on integration of washing schools in national policies, the development of national strategies, whether washing schools was included in sector coordination reviews for both wash and education sectors. And then lastly, we also looked at, and I think this is I think maybe more specific to accountability, we looked at whether countries developed national monitoring systems and whether these were effectively put to use. Our results were, I think, only a third of countries had such national monitoring systems at hand. And even in these instances, local level implementation of these monitoring mechanisms were not necessarily there. So I don't know if that answers your question. Thank you.
Well, I think it does greatly. Thank you. Thank you so much. The other question came from Glenn Kirkland. It's really asking for your opinion. What do you believe are the factors that are limiting funding from a national level, from the national level to reach the schools? So what do you think are some of the limiting factors, for funding to come from the national level to reach the schools? Thank you.
I think in the Western Central African region, one, I think there would be, I mean, I'm talking off the top of my head, but I think two reasons come to mind. One is that a lot of these programs are donor funded. Let me correct, because I think the question is asking about national funding.
Yes.
So if we're talking about government, national funding of washing schools programs, one of I think the major limiting factors is ownership of washing schools as a theme. It's often lost between the education sector and the water or sanitation or whichever sort of wash adjacent sector is in the country. It often falls between the cracks. Although this has been changing over the past couple of years with increasing advocacy with the increasing advocacy by I think by UNICEF and its and partners with education, with the education sector, I think they are facing a lot of competing priorities in the region, as it's one of the regions that has the highest number of schools has the highest number of children out of schools. So it's hard to place it in the agenda and sort of lay out why washing schools is important for children.
Okay. Great. Thank you so much, Tamir. I think it's. I think this tends to be a challenge in many countries because the budgeting sometimes is concentrates more on the issues of provision of the actual education and not so much on facilities like water, sanitation, perhaps even electricity. So sometimes you wonder who should budget and so on at the national level. But it's something that we need to continue supporting. There's a comment from Will Tillett, which I don't know if you, are you able to see the comment, Tamir?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's okay, basically great. A comment. I think it's basically requesting if you can connect with him. They have a program known as United Purpose that builds a system strengthening and social accountability element in Washington schools. So if you're able to
I will get in touch with Will. Thank you.
Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. So the next question comes from Rawlings. He's asking, it might be she. From your research, is there a magic bullet or golden thread to sustaining WASH in schools? I think this is a very interesting question.
Yeah, I mean, I'm hesitant to mention any magic bullets because I think the lesson from today's sessions is that there are no magic bullets. And I think what our research showed is that I think when Washington schools was sort of becoming popular in the region, one of the first sort of key messages was that it needed to be integrated into policies. And now that we are getting to that stage where a lot of countries have integrated into their policies, I think we're realizing that in itself. So I'd be cautious in offering any magic bullet. But at this stage, I think what we notice is that sort of national will, that the national will needs to be translated to local level planning. That sometimes you can even you can have these national budget lines in place, but that does not necessarily translate to actual change on the ground. So how do we? And maybe this is an area that needs further research. How do we link these national policies to? How do we create mechanisms that link national policies to local level implementation?
Okay, great. Tell me, this is just a side question. At the national level, who is the budget holder? Is it the Ministry of Education or Ministry of Water or maybe ministry that is responsible for decentralization or local government?
In most cases, it is the Ministry of Education. It usually falls under quality of education. So reconstruction of water facilities, classrooms, that's where it's usually integrated.
Okay. So at the moment, Kevin, these are the questions that I had or that I could get from the chat.
I guess we're coming near to the end of two papers anyway. But I'd just like to say, Tamir, it was a good presentation. You mentioned about, in your response to one of the questions, you said that it's difficult to persuade national stakeholders to look at washing schools. I just wondered whether it's worth UNICEF or others to come up with a sort of advocacy tool to show of all the benefits of WASH in schools and hence the need for adequate budgets and staffing. To do it, but maybe somebody's already thought of that. I don't know.
I think there have been multiple initiatives in the past, and the sort of advocacy briefs that have been developed addressing the importance of washing schools. Addressing the importance of washing schools. But I think the challenge has also been that sometimes the conversations happen at the national level, and that we might need to do advocacy work at different decentralized levels as well. So I think that's one of the, maybe that's how we can take your suggestion forward. Yeah. How do we get all actors at all levels on the same
page? Great, thanks. Also, Mark is suggesting, have you looked at provision of WASH training in teacher training schools? So influence the teachers first is an idea.
Yeah, a lot of countries do have do make provisions for WASH training under, it usually falls under hygiene education in teacher training schools. So it might be a matter of expanding on this idea of hygiene education to other aspects of WASH as well. Whether it's water access, sanitation, menstrual hygiene, and menstrual health.
Okay, well, thanks for the discussion. It's very interesting. It's something we're all interested in, I'm sure, washing schools. But I'll draw the session to a close now. So thanks a lot.